I appreciate the good spirit I felt here this morning. Testimony shared, the song shared, everybody that was participated in the service, those that sung in the choir, greatly appreciated. The Lord's just touched us this morning with His Spirit. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, starting in verse 1. And here the Bible says, "We then as workers together with Him beseech you also that ye receive not the grace of God in vain. For He saith, I have heard thee in the time accepted, and in the day of salvation have I succored thee. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. Giving no offense in anything, that the ministry be not blamed, but in all things approving ourselves as the ministers of God, in much patience, in afflictions, in necessities, in distresses, in stripes, in imprisonments, in tumults, in labors, in watchings, in fastings, by pureness, by knowledge, by long-suffering, by kindness, by the Holy Ghost, by love unfeigned, by the word of truth, by the power of God, by the armor of righteousness on the right hand and on the left, by honor and dishonor, by evil report and good report, as deceivers and yet true, as unknown and yet well known, as dying, and behold, we live, as chastened and not killed, as sorrowful, yet away rejoicing as poor, yet making many rich, as having nothing, and yet possessing all things." Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you so much for this opportunity to once again stand behind this pulpit this morning and preach from this word. God, I pray that you help us. Lord, we need you to preach it for us. Lord, you know what we have prepared. God, we just pray that you lead, God, correct. Lord, we're thankful for each person sitting here in this congregation this morning. Lord, I pray that this word does a mighty work within their heart. God, that we receive it. And Lord, that we listen. Lord, and we retain these words and what you would have us to know from it. And God, we just thank you this morning. These things we ask in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. C.T. Studd is a famous missionary that you may have heard one of his famous quotes that he made. He was a missionary to several places, China, India, and Africa. And one of his famous quotes, somebody asked him one time about his walk with the Lord and what his desire was for the Lord. And he said, "Some wish to live within the sound of a church or a chapel bell. I want to run a rescue shop within a yard of hell." This was a man that was determined to preach the gospel, to spread the gospel to all creatures, just like the Great Commission demands Christians to do. And that was his desire. It wasn't to huddle himself up in a church. It wasn't his desire to be within the church to be able to reach people. The Great Commission says for people to go. It didn't say for them to come. It said for us to go. And that was his desire, was to tell others about Christ. He wanted to be right there within the yard of hell, pulling folks out of that fire, as we should desire that today, to see that folks do not perish in that everlasting lake of fire, which is the destiny of each person that is not accepted for Christ. That is where they're going to end up. And so each Christian should have a desire in their heart this morning to see that that doesn't happen. And we're going to look at some things this morning, and I was studying for the messages for this week for Sister Hazel, and I was stricken with an overwhelming urgency in the gospel, in spreading the gospel. And I started thinking about all these folks out there. Here Hazel lived a good age, almost 93. She's been 93 in April. Lived all that time. And you know, but most people don't get that opportunity. There are several that's blessed by that. We have people here that's blessed. Live a good age. The Lord has blessed them greatly. They've lived many years. But the majority of people don't have that privilege to live that long. We have a short time here on this earth. And as we may think, as we get older and older, boy, it's been a long life. But just like I was talking, Christine was talking this morning, how time is just passing by so fast. And we look back on these things, and she mentioned that, you know, our anniversary is coming up. 27 years, my goodness. It's just been just a blink of an eye. As we go through this life, and you know, we live it to its fullest, we try to anyway, it goes by so fast. And I can't help but believe that at the end of our lives, we look back and we say, man, it just flew. What all I could have done. How many opportunities that I might have passed up. All these things that I could have done and how I wish I'd have done them. And I know beyond the shadow of a doubt, there's going to be regrets at the end of our lives. I've already, at 45, regretted so many things that I could have done, should have done, that I let go by. But I want us to look this morning at some things. Based on Scripture, I want to make a case for urgency. And that now is the day of salvation. Now. Verse 1 of our Scripture, opening up, the Apostle Paul penning these words down, inspired by God. We then as workers, together with him, beseech you also that you receive not the grace of God in vain. Now I noticed the first thing as I was reading that he made mention of the word here. He says we as workers. Who's he talking about? This we that he's mentioning. I didn't see that he was including other people in his text here. We know that he was writing this to the church of Corinth, and he had a sense of urgency. Now this church, this was a great church, but it had a lot of issues in it. They were doing a lot of things they shouldn't have been doing. They were doing a lot of things they knew better than doing it. They were getting a lot of false prophets coming in and teaching them contrary to the right way. And Paul, his letters to the Corinthian church was simply an outline for how the church should operate and how the people in the church body, should operate. And I saw this thing last week that was very, very good. It was a sign that said, we're not going to church. We are the church. We may be going to a building, but we, folks, we are the church. And Christ expects us to fulfill his commission through us. We are the body of Christ. I want us to notice, first of all, Paul talking about we as workers. He's not specifically talking about ministers. He does mention ministers on down. He's not specifically talking about evangelists or deacons, or Sunday school teachers. And when he says this word we, he's including everyone in the body of Christ. So you can look at that, and as you see him write that down, when he says we, then put your name right there. For example, if he was saying this, he would say, Byron, me and you, as workers together with him, are going to be doing these things. Each one of you, put your name right there. Instead of saying we and thinking of somebody else, think of you. It's you. First of all, I want to recognize that Christ is the head of the body. That's perfectly plain through Scripture. Christ is the head of the body. And without him, nothing else is going to exist. Christ always is first. If you go all the way back to the first verse, first chapter of our Bibles, it's going to say, in the beginning, God. Everything begins with God. Everything. Nothing that we do, no decision that we make, any time we make plans, anything in our life, it all depends upon God, because it always begins with God. It always has, always will. He is the supreme ruler. He's one. He's the one in the beginning. In the beginning was God. So as we do things as a church body, the very first thing that we want to do is make sure that God is first. If there's something that we have in our heart that we think God's laid in our heart to do, a ministry perhaps, something, an activity, the first thing we need to do is consult God and find out if it's his will. Because we'll do a lot of things in our own will, in our own flesh, that will have us do. I can't tell you the amount of times that I've concocted schemes and plans and activities and things, and something I want to do, I desire to do it, and sometimes the Holy Ghost has led me to do those things. A lot of times it's me that's led myself to do things. And I start doing these things and try to make them happen, and I'm just fighting, and things just don't work out. And why? Because I left out the most important ingredient in the whole thing, and that was God. He is to be consulted, number one, first, in everything that we do. If there's an issue that comes up, the first thing we do is say, what does God have for this issue? What does God say about this certain problem? That should be the number one thing that we remember. So, first of all, I want to recognize Christ is the head of the church, and he is to be consulted. He's always first. Second, as he talked about we, the workers together with him, he encompassed all of us, not just me as the pastor, not just Mr. Buckner and OC and Frank as deacons, not just the Sunday school teacher we had here, but every one of us. And in the gospel ministry, there's something that's needed. Every church, every pastor, every ministry requires something, and that is faithful workers. Faithful workers is a requirement of the ministry. And we're going to see that in 2 Timothy. If you'll turn there real quick. 2 Timothy chapter 2. And Paul is instructing his young son in the faith, Timothy, of qualifications of faithful worker. And Timothy is going to be pastoring this church, or he's pastoring the church. Paul's giving him instructions, as he always did. He instructed him on his ministry, what to look for, what to include, what to do, what not to do. And in 2 Timothy 2, verse 1, Paul lists some qualifications. He says, "Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace." That's the first qualification. That is in Christ Jesus. Verse 2 says, "And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men, who shall be able to teach others also." That's the second qualification. Number 3, verse 3, "Thou therefore endure hardness." If you're going to be a faithful worker, you've got to endure hardness. "As a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that worth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life." If you're going to be a faithful worker, you cannot entangle yourself with the affairs of this life. You've got to keep your focus upon the mission, and that is to spread the gospel of Christ, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. Jesus is the one that chose us to be a soldier. And if we're going to be in battle for him, be a warrior for him, we've got to keep on the right road and not entangle ourselves with the things of this life. "And if a man also strive for masteries, yet is he not crowned, except he strive lawfully." The way this is worded, this masteries, is mentioning, it's kind of got the reasoning behind it, is trying to achieve in the games. Paul a lot of times wrote about the games, because that's what this time period they would do things, sports games and things. And he would always make references to those types of things. And so he says, a man is striving for the masteries, that's to achieve that goal, to achieve that crown, to achieve that trophy, if you would want to call it that. He's not crowned unless he strives lawfully. Now, we've seen people try to strive unlawfully, do things on the sly, do things that's not right, and how they fail. But if you do it the right way, if you want to be blessed by God, do it the right way, you're going to do it the lawful way, the way that Christ would have you to do. And so you need to make sure that you labor. Verse 6 says, "The husbandman that laboreth must be the first partaker of the fruits." This word labor, or husbandman, is the same as you might call a farmer. Joe right here talks about farming quite a bit. And I remember this past summer that he shared with us some big old watermelons. I love watermelons. He brought a watermelon to us one day. I tell you what, I could barely carry the thing. It must have weighed 50 pounds. Biggest watermelon I've ever seen. But I want to tell you something. Joe labored in the garden to see that those watermelons were produced. The Bible says right here, if the husband laboreth, then he must be the first partaker of the fruits. I guarantee you that Joe, before he gave anybody watermelons, he went and sampled one before everybody else. I bet you, as he was checking those things, he was stumping on them, he was looking at them, he was checking them out, and I bet you one day, I don't know this, but I bet you one day he cut into one and took a big piece and took a bite out of it and said, "Boy, that tastes good, that's sweet." Because I know, as I've been raised up in gardens, with my dad teaching us, you know, in the gardens, and we would do things, we'd be out there picking, and we raised strawberries before. Who do you think got the first strawberry out of that patch? It was me. Because as I was going around pulling weeds and things, I was picking off strawberries and putting them in my mouth and eating them. And that one that labored, he's going to be the first partaker of these fruits. And so to be a fellow helper here, a faithful person to be able to help the ministry, we must be a laborer. I believe with all my heart, the pastor of the church should be the hardest working person in that church. I believe without a shadow of a doubt. If you've got a lazy pastor on your hands, you've got somebody that's going to be slothful, he's not going to be doing his job. The pastor should be the hardest worker in the church. But the pastor should not be the only worker in the church. The church body is made up of many people. There's many jobs, there's many things that each person can do. So he's not the only one to labor. It takes us all. He says that we, as workers together, with him. So each person has a job to do. But what your job is, I don't know. The Lord can show you what that job is. It says in verse 7 of 2 Timothy 2, "Consider what I say, and the Lord give thee understanding in all things." Now, a lot of us like to get lazy. We like to, we want to read the scripture, and we want to see what's in there, but we don't want to apply it to ourselves. Well, Paul says right here, "Consider what I say, and the Lord will give thee understanding in all things." I've seen people that come to me with a question, and I'll say, well, this is what the Bible says, and I want you to consult the Bible and read what the Bible says. And they read that, but they don't like what the Bible says, and so they want to ignore that, and they want to go to somebody else and ask their opinion. They don't want, really, the Lord's opinion, because they don't want to apply that. But Paul says, if you consider what I say, and this is right here in Scripture, and the Lord will give the understanding in all things. So, we've got to be strong in the grace of Christ Jesus. We've got to be able to teach others. We must endure hardness. We cannot entangle ourselves in the affairs of this world. We must strive lawfully. We must labor, and we must have a good understanding. Those are qualifications of someone that's trying to further the gospel, to fulfill the Great Commission. Not just me, not just the deacons, not just the teachers, everyone. We'll make that crystal clear this morning. So if we're able to do all these things, he says that you receive not the grace of God in vain. That was the second thing he said. As we as workers together, him beseech you that we receive not the grace of God in vain. What does he mean by that? Have you ever known someone that professed Christ as their Savior? You never saw a difference in their life. You never saw them do anything different than what they did the day they were saved. I'm not doubting anyone's salvation. If someone's been saved, they've been saved. But a person that's saved is going to be, they're going to show a difference. You're going to see the difference in their life. The Bible's very clear on that. You're going to know them by their works. The Christ gives you that new creature. Grow in him, and you will see a difference in him. He's saying, don't forsake this grace. Don't make it in vain. Christ gave you this grace. He died on the cross to save you from your sins. You accept him as your Savior. Don't you take that in vain. Don't make his work on the cross mean nothing. And we'll see that come out through our works. Works are not for salvation. Works come after salvation. And it's a desire that we have in our hearts to work for him. So we can't go living about our lives just like the world does. You know those Christians that profess Christ, and then they live exactly like the world. You don't see them in church. You don't see them participating in the things of God. You don't see them making any difference at all in the kingdom of God. Why? Because they're not laboring. They're not fulfilling the commission. They're not doing what Scripture says. And so therefore, they're not taking that grace like they should. They're taking it in vain. He didn't do this, you know, for us to take in vain. So I want to tell you something. I honestly believe this. There are husbands, there are wives, there are children, there are parents, there's grandparents, there's friends, there's co-workers, there's acquaintances that everybody here knows that for some reason somebody that said they were Christian has harmed the effect of Christ in their life. They've harmed their ability to come to Christ. They've harmed Christ's work on the cross because of the way they live their lives. But yet they go around saying that I am a Christian. But yet their life does not reflect that. What that does is that minimizes Christ's work on the cross. And through your life, you are affecting somebody else's life. If I say that I'm saved, but I go and live exactly like the guys that I work for or work with, and I go to the bar and sit behind the bar and I drink, I'm no different from them. Somebody walks in that door and sees me sitting there with a drink in my hand, what does that do? That immediately throws up a flag and says, I thought he was a Christian. Same thing with other things in our lives. You go into a place that you know you shouldn't be going into. Some nasty place where they sell dirty books or whatever it is. And somebody sees you go in there. You have already ruined your Christian walk. You've already ruined your witness, your testimony. And you've put a hamper on their ability to be able to come to Christ. Because they see you living your life like that. And there's nothing different about you. Friends, there's people going to hell today because of the way Christians have lived their lives. And I'm burdened today for the urgency that people need to understand that their need is a Savior. And if we're going to be harming our walk, we're going to be harming the work of Christ, there's something detrimentally wrong in our lives, and we need to change. We need to get things cleaned up. In Antioch, it says the Bible that in Antioch, they were first called Christians. This word Christians is Christianos. And it means followers of Christ. They were mocking those that were Christians is what they were doing. The word Christians wasn't meant as a good term, a nice term, something that they were really trying to, you know, make them look good. They were saying they're the ones that's following that Christ, that one that was crucified. And so the term was not meant to be a good term to begin with. And we take on that word Christian because we say that we are a follower of Christ. Sadly, many people that have accepted Christ as Savior are not a Christian. Everyone is not a Christian. There's some religions that say I'm a practicing this or I'm a practicing that. We almost should start using that term. I'm a practicing Christian or I'm a non-practicing. Because you're one or the other. A Christian is one that practices following Christ or following after Him. So we don't want to put any kind of hamper on the work of Christ and be like the world. Now, verse 2 of our text, and this is where we're getting our main topic from. Verse 2 says, "For he has said, I have heard thee in a time accepted. In the day of salvation have I succored thee. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation." Scripture plainly says that now is the day of salvation. Now. And some people interpret that to say today is the day of salvation. You could probably look at it that way. But today could mean from, you know, the rising sun to the end of sun. But the Bible says it's right now. Right now. There's people that need right now for salvation. And now is that time. And we need to be urgent in this today. There is nothing standing in the way between the Lord coming back on that cloud of glory and that trumpet sounding, that voice loud and calling us home, going on that cloud with Him to be with Him in heaven. There's nothing holding that back right now. That could happen any minute. I wouldn't be surprised at all to walk out this door and that trumpet sound and let's go. There's nothing holding that back. We don't know when Christ is going to return. He may return while we're still alive, or we may meet Him after death. Either way, we're going to be going from this life. There's nothing going to be able to allow you to stay here. You're going one way or the other. You're going. But Paul says here in this verse 2, "Behold, now is accepted time." He was taking this as a direct quote from the Old Testament, by the way. This was in Isaiah 49:8. This is the Father speaking to the Son. And he says in Isaiah 49:8, "Thus saith the Lord, in an acceptable time have I heard thee. In a day of salvation have I helped thee. And I will preserve thee and give thee for a covenant of the people to establish the earth to cause to inherit the desolate heritages." God, His plan of salvation, we saw that it was for the Jews. And He said, "No, not for the Jews." Christ said, "It's not just for the Jews. It's for the Greek. It's for the Gentiles. It's for everyone." By the grace of God, we were included in the plan of salvation. By the grace of God. And so Paul is saying here, a direct quote from the Old Testament prophecy. And he says, "Now is that acceptable time." And I remember over in John 17, I wrote this down. In John 17, verses 1 through 5, Jesus speaking. And he says, "These words spake Jesus, and lifted up his eyes to heaven, and said, Father, the hour is come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee, as thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. I have glorified thee on earth, I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was." We have clear indication from Jesus Himself that He was here before the world was. Jesus is the Creator. In the beginning was God and Jesus. Jesus was here in the beginning. He says, "Glorify which I had with thee before the world was. I've done the work. I was faithful. I was obedient. I did what you asked me to do. I came here and I spoke to men, and they get to know me. They get to know you through me. I've done that work. Now, Father, my work is finished here. We've spread the gospel here. These people know it. It's time, Lord, now. Take me back to where I was in the glory." And He's now sitting on the right hand of the Father, making intercession, by the way, for you and for me. That's what He's doing there now. Now, there's going to be a time that every person, the Bible says, everyone, the Bible says, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he has done, whether it be good or bad. That's in 2 Corinthians. Again, the Apostle Paul writing here. And this is just in the chapter right before the one we were just, our opening text is from, chapter 5. He says that everyone must appear. He didn't say that some have to appear. He didn't say that only the preachers have to appear or only so-and-so has to appear. He says we all have to appear before the judgment seat of Christ. Now, this is not referring to the great white throne judgment where those that have not accepted Christ will be cast into everlasting burning lake of fire, but it's talking about us being at the judgment seat of Christ to be judged for those things that we did, both good and bad, say. There's going to be a time, if you're saved, you're going to stand in front of Christ, you're going to answer for those things. You're going to answer for the things that you should have done, could have done, would have done, that you didn't do. I don't know how it's going to work out. I don't know. Some people said that they imagined a large screen and your life being played before you. But it is going to be a public trial. It's going to be a public judgment. Everybody's going to be there. Everybody's going to know. But those things that we harbor in our heart, in our minds, in our lives, those things that we think are secret from everybody, they are secret right now. But in the front of Christ, the judge, they're no longer secret. All of our works will be known, both good and bad. So how we live our lives right here is going to be the most important thing. The most important thing in our life is not how much money we can accumulate. It's not how great of a car we can drive, how big of a house we can own, or all these activities that we think are so important. And, you know, all these things to us are so important. We put so much importance upon activities and doing things for us. And what can I do to enhance my life and to make my life better and to be like these people over here that get to go to this place all the time? I've told this before, but I had a boss one time that said that everybody needed to make a list of top 20 things in their life that they've not done that they needed to accomplish before they died. And this was in front of a whole bunch of people, corporate people, as we sat there at the table eating. And he started naming off his list of things that was most important in his life that he was going to accomplish before he died. And the things that he listed, I wouldn't even have on my list. It was to see the fireworks in the bay in Australia on the 4th of July. It was like the top 5 thing in his life. Riding down some mountain on a bicycle that's supposedly dangerous or something. That was in his top 10 things that he wanted to do before he died. Parachuting was one of his top things. Bungee diving was one of his top things. Friends, this kind of thinking, this is so self-centered and selfish, and things that matter nothing. When that man closed his eyes in death, all those things that he did, all those experiences he had, all these top 20 things are going to mean nothing, absolutely nothing, when he closes his eyes in death. What's going to matter when he closes his eyes in death is where he opens his eyes after he dies. And there's two places you open your eyes after you die. One of those places is heaven. The other place is a place called hell. H-E-L-L. It's a burning lake of fire. Those are the two places that you wake up. And those are the two places you see after you die. One or the other. You're not going somewhere else. You're not going to a place called purgatory. You're not going to any kind of holding cell. You're not going anywhere where somebody can pray you out of trouble and pray you out of hell. You're not going there. After you close your eyes in death, you're going to heaven or you're going to hell. You don't have any other options or choices. The Bible doesn't give you any other options. And the only way you're getting there is through the shed blood of Jesus Christ if you accept Him as your Savior. That's the only way. Jesus said the only way to the Father is through me. He was very clear on that point. I heard some people on television saying that there was other ways. Somebody said that Jesus was a way. Jesus was not a way. Jesus is the way. There's no way. It's not through some kind of... They get down and they get in some kind of trance and they get in these things in their body. They try to get in some kind of outer experience and they say that they've seen heaven and all these things. That is just a bunch of baloney. That's not true. The Bible doesn't ever mention anybody being able to do that. The only way that you're going to get to heaven, when you close your eyes in death, if you're going to be in heaven, it's because you've accepted Christ as your Savior. As clear and plain as it can be. When we get up there, when we get in front of Christ, all the excuses, all the times that we could have shared the gospel with somebody, all the things that we should have done, could have done, would have done, the things that He laid on your heart to do that you did not do, you have no excuses at that point. We're all going to be Mel Tillis's once we get in front of Christ. That's what we're going to be doing because we have no excuse whatsoever. There's not one of us going to have an excuse. It's all going to be just clear as day. You did not do this. Or you did. It's just going to be as plain as that. I want to tell you something. There's people today dying and they're going to go to hell. And it's because Christians have not reached them yet. I want to list some things for you. We've got a thing that we call the Roman Road of Salvation. I've got this on our website. A lot of people use this as a plan of salvation. It's very important. The steps in the Roman Road are very important. And it gives you a clear outline of how you come to salvation. But I want to give you some other things that are necessary in salvation. And I'm a firm believer that a person has to repent to be able to be saved. I believe a person needs to know that they're a sinner. And without knowing that you're a sinner, how are you going to be saved if you don't know you're a sinner? There's nothing to be saved from. The word saved means to be saved from something. So we've got to be saved from something. What is that something we've got to be saved from? Sin. If we don't know that we're a sinner, if we can't recognize we're a sinner, how can we be saved? The Bible's pretty plain. Acts 3 and 19 and 20 says, "Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out. When the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord, and he shall send Jesus Christ, which was before was preached unto you." Mark 1, 14 and 15. "Now after that John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God, and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel." What's that word repent mean? That means to change, to change your mind, to go away from that, to turn from it. Now, what are you turning from? Your sin. What else would we have to turn from? What else? Repentance is a necessary step. If we can't repent, if we don't know that we've got a problem, how are we going to be able to be saved? I mentioned it already. Jesus is the only way. John 14 and 6. Jesus said unto him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh unto the Father but by me." No other way. It's a one-to-one, on-one relationship with Christ that allows you to go to heaven. Nothing else. Now, first of all, to know that we've got sinner life, we've got to realize we're a sinner. And the Bible is very clear that every person is a sinner. Somebody said, "Well, so-and-so surely is going to go to heaven because I've never seen him or her do anything bad at all. They've lived a life just like a saint. Boy, surely they're going to go to heaven." Surely not. If they've not been saved, they will not. They will not. You can go through this life and you can be Mother Teresa or whoever else they want to lift up these days. And you're not going to go to heaven unless you've been saved through Jesus Christ. It's the only way. Romans 3 and 23. "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." That word all, A-L-L, that includes everyone. It didn't exclude anyone. It didn't say all but Byron. All but so-and-so, all but John, all but Frank, all but Fred, all but Joe. It didn't say that. It said all. All of sin. Romans 5 and 12. "Wherefore, as by one man sin entered the world, and death by sin, so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned." This one man, sin entered in through was Adam. As he sinned in that garden, partaking of the fruit. From that, our sin nature came. From that point on, all have sinned. It didn't exclude anyone. But Christ died for those sins. Romans 5 and 8. "But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." He didn't say yet when we were going to be, or as we used to be, but right now, as sinners, he died for us. He came and died. They were in for the sins of the past, the present, the future. He died for all sin. Penalty for sin, the reason he had to die. Right there, Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." So the only way that we can defeat death, the only way we can defeat sin, the only way we can ever reach heaven and escape hell is to have this sin penalty paid for. How are we going to pay for that? How could we ever pay for it? We can't. There's not enough money in Fort Knox to pay for the sins of one person. There's not enough to pay for that.
What paid for it? Back where we said, Romans 5 and 8. "God commended his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." We're coming up on Easter next month. It's coming up real soon. And we're going to be celebrating a risen Savior. Why are we celebrating a risen Savior? Because first we had to have a Savior that died. He first had to die for us to celebrate His resurrection. He died to save us from those awful, terrible, wicked sins, and that penalty that we had to pay for sins, He paid with His death. He paid it with His blood. So we didn't have to do it. We didn't have to pay for it. So how do we come to Christ? First of all, like I said, we got to realize that we're a sinner. We come to Him. I am a sinner. I'm a sinner. He receives sinners. Romans 10:9, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God has raised Him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth into righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Pretty clear. Pretty clear. Confess with your mouth. Confess with the mouth of the Lord Jesus. Believe in your heart that God's raised Him from the dead, and thou shalt be saved. We can be assured of this. Romans 10:13, the next verses up. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It didn't say he might be saved, or if he does good, he'll be saved, or if he'll wear the right clothes, he'll be saved, or if he'll eat the right food, he'll be saved, or any of these things. He says he shall be saved. Shall. Not shan't, or couldn't, or wouldn't, or can't, but shall. Shall means yes. Yes, it's happening. It's clear as day. So we see in the next verses in our opening text there in 2 Corinthians 6, verse 3. And he gives all these things to make sure the ministry is not blamed for any problems. And we'll just go through those quickly. We won't spend a lot of time on them. But verse 3 says, giving no offense in anything, that the ministry be not blamed. But in all things approving ourselves as the ministers of God in much patience and afflictions and necessities and distresses. And already somebody's saying, well, right there, Brother Byron, it's talking about the ministers of God. It's not talking about me. It's talking about you. It's talking about preachers. It's talking about pastors. No. No. He opened up and he said, we, as we work through Him, we work with Christ, we're all ministers of God. Once we've accepted Christ as our Savior, we are all ministers of God. We may not all be pastors or preachers or evangelists or deacons or teachers, but we are all ministers of Him at that point. So he's saying, so that the ministry is not blamed, that we all must do things to prove ourselves as ministers of God. Patience in afflictions and necessities and distresses and stripes and imprisonments and tumults and labors and watchings and fastings. By pureness, by knowledge, by long-suffering, by kindness, by the Holy Ghost, by love unfeigned. You want to talk about love unfeigned. I've witnessed these past few weeks love unfeigned. I've seen people come to the aid of folks that, not even family members. And I talked about this at the funeral. I'm not trying to bring up memories for anyone, but I want to tell you what. First of all, I want to say this. I am so proud of this church. I am so proud of how the members of this church pull together anytime there's a need. I've been a lot of places, and I've seen a lot of things, and I've seen a lot of churches and things that people don't care. Every time that I visited the hospital, every time that I visited the home, everything that happened any place, there was somebody there. Somebody there. Making sure that somebody was comforted. The first night we found out in the emergency room, went in there, there's church members sitting there waiting. Going to the hospital, there sits church members all in the room. And at the funeral and at the graveside, nearly the entire church was there. I know some of you couldn't be there for reasons, weather and things like that. Even in the threat of a tornado watch, as we went on that very night over to the house, church members all in the living room, all in there. There wasn't even hardly an extra seat. My, the love that I saw come from this church in the time of need. And how that we should have that testimony. The world should know that. The world should know that those that follow Christ, those are the Christians, those little Christos, that's the way we are. That's the way we act. So the ministry is not going to be blamed because we're doing the right things. Love unfeigned. Verse 7, by the word of the truth, by the power of God, by the armor of righteousness, on the right hand and on the left, by honor and dishonor, by evil report and good report, as deceivers and yet true, as unknown and yet well known, as dying, and behold, we live, as chastened and not killed, as sorrowful, yet always rejoicing, as poor, yet making many rich, as having nothing, and yet possessing all things. Friends, I want to ask you something this morning. Charlotte, if you want to come and play on the piano. I want to ask you something this morning. I want you to be totally honest, truthful, because God knows the truth, and you know the truth. Are you doing the things that He asks us to do? Are you doing them? You know, we've talked about many things that we should be doing as Christians, as the body of Christ. We know if we're guilty or not. Christ knows if you're guilty or not. Are we doing those things? And if we're not, why are we not doing them? I'll tell you, there's been times I've been lazy. There's times I've been putting off the things I needed to do. I've done it and I've regretted it. Why? Why are we doing it? We want to be known as Christians. Everybody in here probably says, I want to be a Christian. I want everybody to know that I'm a Christian. But it's not just in words. It's in deeds. It's in the things that come from us. It's present in the fruits that we produce, that we have Christ in our lives. Are we living exactly like the rest of the world, or are we living like a Christian? Just saying you're a Christian don't make you a Christian. I could say that I'm a car and I can go sit in the garage over there, but I'm not a car, because there's nothing proving that I'm a car. But I can tell you if I'm a Christian or not, and I can live a Christian life, and I can prove that by living a Christian life. But if we're going to live like the world, and act like the world, and talk like the world, and walk like the world, and not make Christ our number one priority, then we're not Christians. We're the world. I was going to stand this morning as she plays. Friends, I can't tell you enough this morning. I can't stress enough how urgent it is that people know Christ. There's somebody in your life right now that you know that's not a Christian. And Christians are given the name of Christ a bad name by the way we walk and the way we talk and the way that we do things. Let's not be that way. We'll be a good influence in people's lives. Let's bow our head. Father, thank you so much this morning for this message. God, I pray that it's helped someone here in some way. God, I pray that we always are walking the Christian walk that you would have us walk. God, not ever bring shame upon the ministry, upon your church, upon your church body. God, I pray that we're always faithful in doing the things that we need to do. God, I pray if there's one here this morning, Lord, that's gotten slipped up, Lord, and gotten short, Lord, maybe backslidden, Lord, not got you in the center of their lives, Lord, and not making you important, God, that today will be the day they make a change. God, to put that old stuff behind them, Lord, and carry on and do the things that they're supposed to do. And God, live that Christian life that you would have us live. Lord, if there's one here this morning, I pray that you make a change in their life. Lord, whether they come to the altar, whether they make it on their own confession, Lord, in their own home or on their way home, God, I pray that you deal with hearts today. And God, show them the way, the truth, and the life. Lord, help us here today. These things I ask in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.